everyone. It's good to see you. I hope you've had a wonderful week. Regardless, we're here to give glory to the Lord this morning. It's good to be in His house. Let me give you a couple of announcements before we begin. First of all, let me remind you, in thanks for all of those who came last Sunday night and decorated the church for Christmas. It looks fantastic as always. And part of that, for the last couple of years, you may remember, we've kind of had our First Baptist Church post office there in the foyer. And so you can put those cards that maybe you would send to church members or that you would normally send, you can put it in that mailbox, save yourself a stamp. At the same time, what we encourage is what you would have sent or spent on the stamps, you can put in the little box that's there, and you can put that will go toward the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Now, you don't have to do that, but we're saying, hey, why not? That's something that you would spend that same money anyway. It's worthy cause, and it would go straight to the missions offering. And so, and just letting you know, starting next week, we will. I want to give you a little bit about Lottie Moon and who she was, what the significance was. I think there's too many times we kind of go through Christmas. We give to the offering, but we don't always talk about the reason why it's named after this woman who did such a mighty work for such a little person. I think one of the trivia is, some of you looked this up this week, how tall Lottie Moon was, because you might be surprised how tall this woman was and what she was able to accomplish. Another thing I want to tell you is family night on the 17th. There will be a movie night that night. I know that there may be some of the posters around saying 6 p.m. We're actually going to start that at 5, so we'll get that corrected for next week. That is simply to say that the movie is about 2 hours long. We know school is still in session, so we still want to be able to get everybody out at a good time where they can get back home. This is a movie that still grade school children could certainly interact with. We've got a copy of I Heard the Bells. Came out last Christmas. It is the story of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow during the Civil War era and tragedies in his life, yet the faith in Christ that sustained him. It is done by the Sight and Sound Theater production. If you know that in the Branson area, then of course Pennsylvania, the other theater that they have, they did their first movie production last year. It was this one, and it is done very, very well. So I would say come. All we're asking is you come with your family, bring your favorite Christmas cookie. We'll have hot chocolate and coffee, and we'll just have Christmas cookies and watch a great movie and enjoy the evening together. And so that'll be on the 17th. That's the day of the cantata, and that evening at 5 o'clock. I also wanted to remind a couple of things. Today, right after the service, if you have a grade school age child, in other words, part of our children's ministry, and they want to participate in the song that the children will be singing on the day of the cantata, on the 17th, then today is the day you need to go immediately after service, go into the family center. You'll be getting some instruction on those things and when the practice times will be, so that on the 17th you'll be ready, your child will be ready to do so. Again, it's not a requirement. It's just saying if your child wants to be a part of that, then we are encouraging you to go after church today to the family center to do that. The other is, you might have noticed the bulletin looks a little different today. This is the theme of the ladies' event that's coming this week, this Thursday night. And so this was just for you. It was part of the package deal. So it didn't cost us anything extra on that. She was just able to print this off. But we wanted to give you kind of a physical reminder, ladies, for you to come in your ornament exchange. You'll see that information on the back of the bulletin and with times and place and everything that you can do. If you want to come, for those ladies that have done this the last several years, it's always a fun night. And they're doing a great job preparing for this one. So I would encourage you to come and be a part of the Thursday evening. So make sure you keep that as a reminder. One last one. Our annual business meeting will take place on the 20th of this month. We've had several different things trying to work out schedules and technicalities on some decisions that need to be made. And so it's caused it to be able to come at the end of the year again. But I want to encourage you to come and be a part of it, not just because we're voting on next year's budget, because that won't be a whole lot different than what we've had. But there are a couple of significant things that we are looking at. And that comes in light of, one, with Matt's announcement that he would be stepping down from the responsibility of youth ministry at the end of this year. And then the other is arising from a need within our children's ministry and helping the children's church program continue and doing well. And so both of those, a youth director position and then a children's church director position, will be discussed at that business meeting. And so we, in talking with staff, in meeting with the deacons, a finance committee that has looked at several different things, we really feel that the Lord has brought help to us from within our own church family. And so for a youth director position, we will be considering Pablo Cruz. I don't know if you've had the chance to meet Pablo yet. Pablo and Elizabeth are not here this morning. Silly excuse. I mean, she just gave birth like Wednesday or Thursday, whatever. She couldn't come to church today. But they got their little one, baby Ariana. She was born Tuesday, I believe that's right. See, it was 8 pounds, 7 ounces, and 24 inches long. So there you go, baby Ariana. So they are home with her this morning. Pablo has been working alongside Matt for the last several months, and God has used him well in our youth ministry. And so we are considering him for this director's position. And then for children's church director, we're actually considering Danielle Gill for that one. We'd be helping to manage and keep the schedules of children's church as well as some other responsibilities. So next week, what I'm going to have is a copy of those job descriptions so that you will be able to see what's involved or what would be involved. And so that long before the business meeting takes place, you can have either your questions ready, or you certainly can come to me or Matt. You can go to the deacons if you have any questions of what's been discussed. You'll have those job descriptions. You'll have all of those things so that we can make the best decision possible for our church and where God is leading us in that. So I hope you'll come on the 20th and be a part. Let me move on. Let me read from the scripture this morning. We've come to worship. Those are things I needed to give to you. But we've come to worship this morning, and we are starting Advent this month. Advent is simply just the recognition of Christ's coming. That the first time as a little baby, that he would come and be our Savior. And then we look forward to the next Advent, his return, and how all things will be made new under his return. And so within that, let me read Romans chapter 15. Starting with verse 8, it says, "For I say that Christ has become a servant to the circumcision on behalf of the truth of God to confirm the promises given to the fathers and for the Gentiles to glorify God for his mercy, as it is written. Therefore, I will give praise to you among the Gentiles, and I will sing to your name." And again, he rejoices, "Rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people." And again, "Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, let all the peoples praise him." And again, Isaiah says, "There shall come the root of Jesse, and he who arises to rule over the Gentiles, in him shall the Gentiles hope." Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. But I myself am also convinced about you, my brothers, that you yourselves are full of goodness, having been filled with all knowledge, and being able also to admonish one another. But I have written very boldly to you on some points, so as to remind you again because of the grace that was given me by God. This hope is what we talk about today. Each week has a theme: hope, peace, joy, or love, and joy, or joy and love, in another word. But each week we will focus on this wonderful attribute and or the understanding from the scriptures of what it is when Christ came and what changed for us, especially Gentiles, the ones who were not ethnic Jews, the ones who didn't have the law, didn't have a hope, and yet the hope came even to them, even to us. And so we'll speak about that this morning, and I hope you are encouraged because of the hope that we have in Christ alone. Let's pray this morning. God, we thank you for what you've given us in Jesus. And we don't say that lightly, because we know that it is inexhaustible to know what you have given us in Christ. And that we would understand that Christ is his title. Messiah is who he is. Jesus was the name that was given to him so that as he walked among this this earth and his people, that they would call him by a name, even the name meaning rescuer. Lord, that we would understand that even his earthly name reflected who he really is, and that is our Savior, Redeemer. Lord, that we this morning would have absolute eternal hope because of Jesus alone. Thank you that we can gather in such a place of warmth and safety. We thank you that you've given us opportunities to see where you're continuing to take us even this next year in the ministries of our church. God, in all things, we want to praise you and honor you most of all. So we thank you for that. And we pray that this morning we can lift up the name of our only hope, and that is Jesus. It is certainly for your glory, it's for our good. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us as we worship the Lord today as we sing Angels from the Realms of Glory?
Forevermore, forevermore, forevermore,
chapter 1, beginning in verse 9. It says, "The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but God. The Word became flesh, and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth." This next song, called Emmanuel, Glory in the Heights, it's a new song that we're going to sing today that speaks of that, this hope that we have in Jesus Christ. The light that came into the world, not just to be born as a baby, but he came for a purpose. And that purpose was to take the punishment of our sin on his shoulders. There's a verse in here that says, "The cornerstone was fastened to a wooden frame. Behold, the Lamb that crushed our curse and died to pay the price of our rebirth." Lamb that crushed our curse and died to pay the price of our rebirth. That's why Jesus came to the world. And so as we sing this next song, as you learn this new song called Emmanuel, Glory in the Highest, even if you didn't get the opportunity to listen to it on our Facebook page, once you hear it and once you familiarize yourself with it, sing along with us.
Grace. Where my
Hope. I mean, I'm asking rhetorically, but I want you to think on it. What is hope? It is It's a good thing that we want, right? That's what we think that it is. It's something we don't have yet, but yet we want it. So whether it is truly good or not, that is our perception of it. And of course, there are a lot of surface-level hopes that we take for granted get us through a given day. You hope this morning, maybe you didn't with a conscious thought, but you hope the car would start. Right? When you get back home, you'll be hoping that everything is still normal at home. There's normal things that we kind of hope for during the day, but there are deeper hopes, and we know that. I mean, this is maybe this isn't so deep this part of the year, but there's a hope that some of you have that whenever they open up that present that you got for them, you're going to hope that they like it. But you know it's a surface level hope because you kept the receipt, didn't you? See, that's how we work that, right? We know that we have a fix within this, but there are other hopes that, well, they actually shape the way that we think. They shape the way that we walk and talk. I mean, think of this, that worry, the opposite of hope, it shapes the way that we think and operate and act as well, doesn't it? I want you to think for a minute, maybe now that we recognize that there is an end to the ceasefire in Israel, that there were several weeks that, I don't know whether it was hope or worry, but for those families that had a loved one that was being held captive, and I mean on both sides, how it would be shaped? I mean, if there was hope, there would have been a positive part of your day in your attitude. There would have been some joy that would have lingered. There would have been a drive to continue in pursuing even daily, mundane, normal tasks because there was hope. But if there was worry, if there was true doubt, then all of those other things would have been probably pushed aside, that kind of backed up. People would have been neglected a little more. There would have been things that you would have left undone because the worry would have not driven you forward. It would have held you back. I want you to see that hope is nothing more than an acting out of the faith that we have. That's really where it comes from. The problem with hope for sinners like us is, well, we want to see our hope. I mean, we want an absolute, without a doubt, guarantee that this is going to take place. And if that is the case, if that is your understanding of hope, then you have to come to terms with the reality that is not hope that you're living with. It's trying to control everything and every outcome. Now, we certainly know we can't do this, but to put our hope in an action or a circumstance by default, worrying constantly about the future, any topic, any individual, whatever facet of life, that is not an exercise of hope, that is worry. Hope is a result of faith. Worry is nothing more than distrust. Romans chapter 8, starting with verse 24, it says, "For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience." Isn't that interesting? Hope, real hope, drives you to patience and joy and peace because there is an absolute expectation. Now, you may not see it, but it is there because it is hoped for. When Christ came to the world the first time, it was foretold, and there were those who lived in hope even then. If you don't remember this, just look up Hebrews 11 this week. Of all of those Old Testament heroes of the faith that we kind of call them, that go through their life that because of the faith, then this is where they lived. This is how they lived. And then there were those who they never saw the manifestation of the Messiah. He never came in their lifetime. And they lived with hope, many of them losing their lives because of that hope. Well, I know we're waiting for his return, but we have the absolute, without a doubt, fact that he did come. And so we can live with the absolute expectation of his coming back to us because we know he will return again. That hope allows us to wait with patience. Let's read this morning in Titus chapter 2. I just want to read verses 11 through 14. "For the grace of God has appeared,
bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. This is who we are. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the hope that we have in Christ. And this morning, I know that, well, we battle against our own heart's desires for what we hope in. God, I pray this morning that we are reminded from the good truth of your word that our hope has already come, that our hope is secure, that our hope is absolute and it is eternal, and that our hope is in nothing on this earth, but that it is one that did come to this earth to prove our hope, and that is Christ. In Christ alone, that would be our hope, not just for salvation or for eternity, but for everyday life, that we might wait for him with patience as a testimony of the goodness that he gives us every day. And Lord, I do ask that you would help us, that your Spirit would help us, that the knowledge that we gain from your word would help us to continue to live in patience, waiting for our blessed hope in your return, Lord Jesus, so that all may know you are the King of Kings. We ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. I want you to see where in these verses it does declare to us first and foremost that Christ is our hope for salvation. I mean, Advent, that word means coming. That is the celebration of Christ's coming. He appeared long ago on that night when those shepherds were standing with their flocks. Bethlehem was crowded. Joseph and Mary were confined to the only little space they could get because there was no room for them in the inn. The grace of God appeared. Now, I am one of those who, in listening to the Christmas story account of Mary and Joseph, you know, arriving into town, knocking on doors anxiously, trying to find a place because she was going into birth that night, I don't know if I ascribe to that. I know that's the way it's told. We've always told it that way. They had gone into town because there had been a decree to go make registration, pay your taxes. The government needed its fill again, and so that's why they went. And so they were there. I know that they had family there. They were probably staying, with wherever they were at, but they had people that they knew that they were able to fellowship with during the days. There were probably other times that they were there because you didn't just show up and then turn right around and go back. That's modern cars for us in our modern travel. They had to go rest, recoup, and then they would be able to travel back, but also because she was about to give birth. And so while they were there, this says the time came for the baby to be born. And so I just want you to understand that night that we sing about, there was a time to really see it and savor it. That there was a time that for those that were surrounding them to really see what was to take place. And the grace of God had appeared. It was the good news that Jesus had come to this world. He did not come simply so we might have a national holiday and buy presents for everyone and eat more cookies than we're supposed to, because we'll say, you know, January's coming, we'll get rid of it then. We know we never do, okay? Again, that's man's hope. The hope has to be seen. That's the way that we look at it. I mean, have you ever noticed with the people that make fun of people of faith, that's what they describe themselves as, is those who trust in science, you know, what they can see, what they can tangibly hold on to? Listen, that's not real hope. I mean, hope is not, if it's a for sure thing that you're holding on to, you don't have to hope for it anymore. It's there, right? So you don't say, I put my hope in what I can see, because there's a lot of things that science cannot answer for us. I don't know, some article or something on the news, I can't remember now, this weekend, and please take this as I am not some kind of man who's talking down about women. The article was how they have found archaeological evidence that might suggest, because they have to word it that way, that women in the cave people days, which didn't exist, by the way, you understand that, but in the cave people days, that women were better hunters than men. And I'm thinking, from archaeological evidence, how could you even pull any kind of evidence up about that? I mean, I don't understand where we can come up with a story from some evidence of where people lived and maybe what they ate. And it just astounds me. I'm getting off track. I'm going to get back on the script here in a little bit. But I just want you to know that when they say, I believe in what the science has told me, they're not holding on to anything tangible there, right? I mean, there's an absolute kind of, you have to make this up to make it fit your story and your faith. But yet they will say, I hope in what I can see. That's not hope. I have a friend, a young man, who some years ago was dealing with anxiety and depression. He dealt with it for a couple of years. It had caused him to have to go be admitted into the hospital. He was on suicide watch more than once. I mean, I went to the hospital. I visited him there. I would counsel with him in my office and other places over and over again. Now he was going to professional counseling as well. It was not a Christian counselor. It was one that the doctor had connected him with. In his therapy, at 20 years of age, he was instructed to build sandcastles as he talked about what was hard in life, what he wanted to change. And the therapy of building the sandcastle was to demonstrate to him how he could build his own world. That somehow within the action of building this world, that he could kind of make it come true. Listen, that's the world's hope. Something to hold on to. Isn't it interesting that it was a sandcastle? How sturdy is the sand? What the scripture tells us about those who build on the sand. This was not hope that they were building into him. This was an attempt to control things. That's the world's hope. Cope, manage. I mean, they told him, listen, you'll never get rid of this. You're going to always deal with this. You will always have this pain, this problem of anxiety. You're never going to get over it, so you're just going to have to deal with it. No victory at all. Now, am I saying that somehow, as Christians, we don't deal with depression or anxiety? Of course not. Are there times where we need to be able to talk to someone? We need to be able to go and seek help? Of course we do. We have some counselors here in our area that are truly Christian counselors, and they will walk you through the truths of the Scripture so that you can see where your hope is not in your circumstance. It's certainly not in a sandcastle. It will be in a person named Jesus. But all that said, that is the world's hope. At best, you deflect. You pass blame. I mean, that's been from the beginning, hasn't it been? Adam and Eve, Genesis 3. Adam says, the woman that you gave me the apple, right? He went ahead and blamed God by blaming the woman. You gave me this woman. Now she's the one who gave. What did Eve say? She said, the serpent deceived me. It was his fault. Our hope cannot be based on our works, our achievements, our progress. It certainly cannot be a comparison of how much of a hot mess we are now than we were 2 weeks ago, 2 months ago, or 2 years ago. The world says manage or maintain, or at worst, walk away. Walking away, of course, does not help anything. Thinking that you can get to the place where you will have no troubles is not possible either. Listen, it's absolute zero. Thanks for coming this morning, right? So glad you're here. Your world's going to have problems all the time. Christians learn that their only hope is Christ. Who is Christ? Jesus of Nazareth lived a life that was sinless, mistakeless, accidentless, okay? There were no mess-ups, no faults, no failures. He was and is perfection. What do we mean by that when we say that? Because it is a doctrine that we adhere to. What do we mean when Christ was perfect? He not only lived a life that followed the Ten Commandments, he fulfilled them. In Romans chapter 3, starting with verse 21, it says, "For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe." Now, why Why would it be where we could have the righteousness of God given to us by faith if Christ had not fulfilled all righteousness? That is how we are able to have access to God. Now, allow me just a minute to set forth. This is just my own coming up with a verse on each one, but there are others that we could use. The account of Christ concerning the law. Commandment 1, you shall have no other gods before me. In John 14:6, Jesus declared, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He was declaring himself God. In commandment number 2, you shall not make for yourself a carved image. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, he was the exact imprint of God's nature. He was not a reflection, although some of your scriptures may say that. It's the best that human nature, human words that we can express, but God in the flesh, that was Christ. He was not an image. He was not a second hand. He was God. Commandment number 3, you shall not take the name of God in vain. Philippians chapter 2, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. His name had been made and was now made above every other name. Commandment 4, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. We read this just 2 weeks ago. Come to me and I will give you rest. He is our Sabbath rest. Commandment number 5, honor your father and your mother. In Luke chapter 22, not my will but yours. Father, right? Remember in the garden? He gave other references of completing, being obedient to the Father's will. That's just one. Commandment number 6, you shall not murder. John 10:10, the thief comes to kill and to steal. I have come that you may have life and abundantly. Commandment number 7, you shall not commit adultery. In Ephesians chapter 5, we see that Christ has loved his church without fault. Commandment number 8, you shall not steal. 2 Peter chapter 1, he has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Nothing has he withheld from his people. Commandment number 9, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. In John 7:18, in him there is no falsehood. Commandment 10, you shall not covet. John 4:14, whoever drinks this living water will never thirst again. He did this and was able to do so because he was God and man, fully God, fully man, those natures never mixing, but always present. And because of this, that means he was and is perfect. He was a perfect sacrifice. No more bulls and goats or sheep or turtle doves. The blood of those animals was temporary. It was ceremonial. It was superficial. The blood that was poured out as a recognition of sin, a cry for mercy, and asking for forgiveness. And it wasn't very effective because they had to do it every year. But his blood was poured out as a gift of righteousness, a covering of mercy, a sin debt that was forgiven, and it was complete. It never had to be offered again because it was perfect. That's why there is no man on the cross behind me. It is empty, as well as the tomb, because Christ is not brought back to be crucified over and over again. It says once for all time. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 8 and 10 through 10, it says, when he said above, you have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings. These are offered according to the law. Then he added, behold, I have come to do your will. He does away with the first order to establish the second. And by that we will have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Salvation is not just a hope of heaven when we die. It is a hope for here and now as well. Amen? So it's not just a hope of salvation. He is our hope for sanctification. Read with me again in Titus chapter 2, verse 12. It says, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age. Now, this is not saying that everyone who lives a moral life is automatically a Christian, right? You've heard the old adage. I think it was reported that Billy Sunday was the first one to say it, that just because you came to church this morning does not make you a Christian, in the same way that just when you go into a garage, does it make you an automobile? That's accredited to Billy Sunday and his preaching and teaching. Moral living, now listen, I'm not saying morals are bad, but moral living is and can be self-serving. Sanctified living is Christ adoring. Now that may seem like semantics, and it is, but it matters. The term sanctification is a doctrine that we as Southern Baptists use to distinguish a person that is growing or has grown in their walk with Christ. Let me read to you from our Baptist Faith and Message, Article 4, Section C. Sanctification is the experience, beginning in regeneration, by which the believer is set apart to God's purposes and is enabled to progress toward moral and spiritual maturity through the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit dwelling in him. Growth in grace should continue throughout the regenerate person's life. Now, I know I said earlier that the comparing of how much of a problem you were 2 years ago to what you are now, that doesn't produce faith. It should be demonstrating that you have faith in something other than your circumstances and in yourself. This shows cooperation between the Holy Spirit working in us to understand and know the Word of God that we might live according to it. Listen, our submission or obedience to what we know from the Scripture does not produce faith either. It simply proves that we have faith. Morality, according to the world, is fluid. It morphs, even from person to person. It hopes in self. It does whatever is best for self. I mean, haven't we all in some form or fashion been told, or maybe told someone, listen, you do what's best for you. I just want to tell you, parents, that is terrible advice to give your child. Do not tell them, do what's best for you. Now, I'm not trying to say you're a bad parent. Think about it from the truths of the Scripture. What we need to be saying is, do what best honors God. And that is what is best for them. That may not guarantee them the most paycheck, or their most popularity. It doesn't guarantee them, you know, the love of a lifetime kind of a situation. Well, what it does guarantee them is eternal security in Jesus Christ. It encourages and displays confidence that they are saved for all time. That alone brings endurance, patience, perseverance, strength that we can do all things because we're waiting for our Lord's return with patience. It is being sanctified or godly living. You might call it holiness. You might, those kinds of things. It's not just a list of do's and don'ts. It is a mindset. It's a philosophy. It's a worldview. Let me tell you what the Scripture says that it is. It says that it is our new identity in Christ that is shaped by the truths of God's Word. A person that is pursuing holiness or sanctification, growing in the Lord, displays to the world around them that their hope is in Christ. It's not in circumstance. Even for those right now that seem to be so worried about what's going on around the world and they're concerned of future times or end times, listen, you can't put your hope in what's happening around the world. You still have to have your hope in Christ because there is a time where this will end. And when it does, it means that Christ came back. It's still in Him. It's not in a circumstance. Listen, Christians know that we're not good, but God is. They're not doing tasks to be rewarded or to avoid trouble or to gain recognition. They do what is based on knowing and understanding. That's the knowledge and wisdom that the Scripture tells us to have. And it's a desire to honor and glorify God with their actions, their words, and their thoughts. But it is not automatic. That's the discipline that comes. That's part of our working with the Holy Spirit in our lives to submit, to obey. I mean, when I was a kid and I would hear sermons like this, I guess I just kind of thought that one day I'm sitting in the pew and the Holy Spirit's going to overpower me and I'll just be good from here on out. That is not how that works. Amen? We battle against it. It's not gained through the building of sandcastles or visualizing your best life. And there's a lot of churches that even preach that. They'll teach you it's about visualizing your success. There was a quote that went out this week from Bethel Church in Redding, California. I know I've talked against them before. I will never speak in favor of them until they repent and teach proper truth. They had a quote that went out basically saying that prayer Let me get this right. Prayer is an act of leadership because when you pray, you are authorizing God to do His will here on earth. That's the most backward thing I've ever seen from a scriptural standpoint. You don't get to authorize God to do anything. You submit to God, right? This is where our obedience, it's not automatic. We're not to build our life through some visualization about what's best for us. Listen, we are learning and knowing what the Word says, and then as life comes at you, the worries, the pain, the sickness, the loss, trials or tribulation, listen, even the joys and celebrations, overwhelming blessings, they respond, Christians, and react more in a way that shows what God's grace has given them in Christ. And so, listen, I know we tend to think about the terrible things that come or the hard things that come at a time of a holiday, especially Christmas. I mean, I know that there are those. This will be the hardest Christmas they've faced because it's the first Christmas without their loved one. And it is not easy. But what is your hope in? Just that time heals all wounds? Listen, time can help things to fade, but a healing only comes by a real hope. A real hope that is expected with absolute. It is an eternal hope. This is where we, even with the blessings, the overwhelming. I mean, I just mentioned about our young couple with their first child. What an overwhelming blessing. And then in that, what are they celebrating with? Like, wow, I'm so glad nature and the universe had favor on us and we got a little baby. I guarantee you that's not coming out of their mouths. I mean, if anything, what he's texted me over the last couple of weeks is, we're thanking God for His provision in all of these things, right? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul, talking about himself, said, "Last of all, as to one untimely born, he also appeared to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me." Paul even knew the mighty things that he was able to accomplish was not because he just somehow mustered up the faith or the will inside of him. It was God working in him all the while. That's how he was not only to be spared from the tragedies that he went through, but that he was able to accomplish the wonderful good works that he was made for. Our sanctification is still in Christ, not just our salvation, but our growing in this life of adversity and change and conflict, the way that we understand our overcoming has been done by Christ, and we are to be able to take advantage of that and the Holy Spirit working in us by enduring all things for the glory of God, because we know that there will be a day of His wonderful return. Read with me again, Titus chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. "Waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for Himself a people for His own possession who are zealous for good works." Listen, the very hope of Christ coming again, He is our hope for glorification. That's another doctrine that we hold to. It's more than just His ruling and reigning here on this earth. I mean, He didn't come to be a conquering king the first time. He will the second. And yet, hope in that is more than just in His coming again. We are also told that all things will be made new like they were before sin entered this creation, including us. I mean, read with me Philippians chapter 3, verse 21. "Our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like His glorious body by the power that enables Him even to subject all things to Himself." We will be remade as well. Can I tell you what our Baptist Faith and Message says about glorification? Because it's Article 4, Section D. It's right after sanctification. Glorification is the culmination of salvation and is the final blessed and abiding state of the redeemed. Man, what's that going to be like? We just get glimpses. I mean, I know what I'd like it to be like. I mean, I'd like to have a little faster metabolism and maybe a little clearer mind and, you know, maybe some other things like that. I don't know what it'll be like. But see, that's my earthly hope, right? That's not my hope in Christ. My hope in Christ would just tell me it will be eternal and it will be as good as it could possibly be. That's all I need to know, right? But it's not just a physical change. It's a spiritual change. Our desires, the conflict and tension we now battle with in our flesh, and the new life that we have in Christ will simply not be when our Lord returns and makes all things new. This life and the sting of sin that it carries will not compare to the glory we will be in the middle of when our Lord returns. And so it's within the celebration of Advent that we not only remember his first appearing, but we really do look to his second coming. Oh, when we sing it, oh, what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, right? When I look upon his face. What will that be like? I know we've sung songs about those things too. Will I dance, or will I fall on my face, or what are those things? I don't know exactly. But I do know that the scripture tells me that will take place. And so my hope is in the fact that he has accomplished all of those things necessary so that I might be able to be in the presence of God. The glory of Christ, from his birth, his perfect life, his perfect atoning death, his victorious resurrection, his glorious return, that is our hope. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 50. Can I tell you, this is a section of a passage that I read often at funerals. I know there is the awareness of our own mortality at a time like that. But as the people of God, I don't know that there's a better encouragement for us to be reminded that yes, that death, it will come. We have sinned, and the result of that has been that death will visit us. Yet it's a transition for a believer. It's a passing through for a believer. It's a sting. It still is a sting. We've still got that, but praise the Lord that there is an overwhelming understanding from this passage of scripture that sting, it's just a second, right? I mean, we experience it through our life, but at final, that sting doesn't get to overwhelm us. It actually is eliminated. Let me read, starting with verse 50. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at that last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. So when the perishable puts on the imperishable, and when mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Not only is he our hope for salvation, he's our hope for sanctification. And then, when this life is done, when all of time as we know it is finished, and the new begins, he is still our hope for glorification. It never changes. It's always Jesus. We need to be okay and excited about the inexhaustible riches in Christ. Your hope in Christ alone is not in vain. That means that you can live a life of absolute hope, because we know we have an absolute salvation from Jesus, who will never leave us but help us in this life as we wait for him to bring us home. Do you have that hope this morning? More than just lighting a candle and saying a prayer. A real hope of knowing that whatever you are walking through right now, be it tribulation or triumph, it is all by the Lord's hand, so that you might see that he is the author and the ruler and the Lord of all things, and that all things are from him and to him, so that he might be our hope. Let's pray this morning. God, we thank you for the truth in your word and the real, absolute, eternal hope that you have secured for us, Lord Jesus, by your life, your obedience, your perfect fulfilling of the law, and then by Because of that, your perfect death, your perfect and atoning sacrifice, the one who would pay the debt of sinners, the one who would be given the dose of wrath meant for others, for sinners, onto yourself, that you might take it to the grave with you, that you would put death to death, so that we may now have hope, not just in this life, but in eternity. Lord, I pray that this morning that we are encouraged by this. I pray that there may be one, if they are not yours, then they are convicted by this. They are cut by this, recognizing that the only healing they may have, the only balm for that wound, would be the grace and the mercy that you have given us in Jesus Christ, and that they would surrender to that truth and put their life into your hands to call out for mercy, to repent or turn from what they had believed, and when thinking about you and life and sin, and turn toward you, knowing that their sins have been against you, and yet you, while we were still sinners, gave yourself for us. But I pray that for those in this room that have no doubt can recall and remember their experience of when they first came to realize you as Lord, I pray you bring that joy back to them. That for this Christmas season, that the way that they guide their own life, the way that they have others and that they influence over, be it children, grandchildren, just spouses, co-workers, friends, relatives, Lord, that we are able to have a display of hope in Christ, not circumstance. A hope that is complete in Jesus alone, rather than in presence or the coming year of maybe the chance of a change here and there. Lord, I pray that we see that it is not the economy that brings us joy. It is knowing that we have an eternal security in Jesus Christ, and that we may display that for all to see. We thank you for that truth, and we ask you, Lord, to have your way with us this morning. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with us as we sing the hymn of invitation, and you come as the Lord is leading you.